control of everything. He knows everything. He sees my sorrow. But in all things, he's still good. Right? Now, there's a lot of times our problems in the present, we can't see that God is good because of where we're at. But if we can look behind, beyond today and just look beyond our present situation, we can still say God is good. So David starts out a song saying, I will praise thee, O Lord, with what? All right. Now, what does that mean? All of what?
All of my soul.
Well, how do you do that?
Give it all to him. I can, you know, sometimes when I know I'm praying and I'm crying and feel it, that I'm giving it all to him.
Okay.
I can just say a prayer and it's over with.
Okay.
You know, so.
Okay. A lot of people praise God with what we call lip service.
Yeah.
Right? God says, you're here, but your heart is far from me. I hear you, but your heart is far from me. That, we're praying because we know that's the thing to do. A lot of people come to church. They'll come and they'll sing hymns because that's the thing to do. They'll come and repeat the scripture because that's the thing to do. But God doesn't want that. God wants your whole being praising him. The psalm I started out my prayer with, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. That's really saying, bless the Lord, I command my soul. I have to speak to myself. With all that's within me, bless the Lord. I got to tell myself, I command you to bless the Lord. Because, you know, I could be talking to y'all, but I could be thinking about 15 other things. You know what I mean? This generation is a multitasker, you know what I mean? But there comes a time when multitasking ain't going to work. I got to praise the Lord. When I'm talking to the Lord, I got to command my soul. Whatever's going on, stop. My 100% concentration and thought is to God. So David starts off saying, I will praise thee, O Lord, with my whole heart. Now God, and it's just because of what? I will show forth his marvelous what? What's that?
All that he's done for us. Created everything. Everything he's done.
I will show forth all thy marvelous work. I will tell. I will remember. I will think about all his marvelous works. Okay? Now, all you have to do is think about one thing that he's done. As soon as you think about that, all these other ones start popping in. I want to turn your attention to Psalms 136. Go to 136. This is David. Psalm, as he's speaking for the whole Israel, the whole church, the whole community of faith. Show thee forth all thy marvelous work. And I'm giving an example, then I'm going to turn around. who's above all other gods, whoever people worship, all give thanks to the God of God, because what? His mercy. What?
Alright,
y'all gotta sing now. Alright? All give thanks to the capital L, Lord of Lords, because what? To him who alone doeth great wonders. Why? To him that by wisdom made the heavens. Why? To him that stretched out the earth above the waters. Why? To him that made great lights. Why? Hey, the sun to rule by the day. Why? The moons and the stars by night. Why? To him that smote, killed in Egypt in their firstborn, and brought out Israel from among them. Why? They were slaves, man. Okay? With a strong hand and with a stretched out arm. Why? To him was divided, check this out, the Red Sea and the parts. Why? And he made Israel to pass through in the midst of it. Why? But overthrew Pharaoh and his host in the Red Sea. Why? To him was led his people through the wilderness. Why? Listen to this. To him was smote or killed great kings. Why? And slew famous kings. Why? All right, y'all get it for me? He starts thinking of one thing, that the Lord is good, and now he's recalling all these marvelous works of God. Because why? Okay, now, keep that in your spirit as we're going to think about righteousness and justice. Because what? How long is forever?
Forever and ever and ever and ever.
You have no idea. You have no idea how long forever is. But his mercy, what? It stands for, it's always going to be. No matter what your situation is, his mercy, what? That should give us some kind of comfort. And no matter what our present circumstances is, we serve a God whose mercy. Okay, here we go. Now, David says, I will praise thee, O Lord, my whole heart. I will show forth thy marvelous works. So we're talking about Israel, but let's look at ourselves. We talked about slavery. Those were our people. They were slaves. They don't see y'all sitting here today, but y'all are no longer slaves. Why? They prayed. They didn't see. But look at y'all. Why? I was sitting out front there, and I was looking at the pictures of the pastors there, and Reverend Turner. They were at Mount Lebanon, I believe they were, right? They had God gave them a vision to build a bigger church, a nicer church. They didn't have no money. They prayed, and somewhere along the line, God made a way. And all of a sudden, in 1966, what's the cornerstone say? What? A building. And there were some that were not letting that passed on and never saw this. Here we are. We come. We're in this church and everything. And we try to beautify God's house. We put lights up. We try to put carpets up. We try to do the right thing. But then a fire comes and destroys the church. Short-sightedly, it's horrible. It's sad. But if we can remember that it's, if we can see further, we will be able to see today when we ain't got to worry about the color of the carpet. When we got lights, we got things that we even didn't even dream of. We got a sound system. We're online and everything. Because one time I get shoes, sneakers, then the sneakers I did got came from the A&P, the market. You know? Nowhere but God's mercy endures. And he loves you. He loved us even before we even was thinking about it. That's why I have so much respect for young kids that come to learn the word of God. Because at my when I was at that age, I was too busy.
Well, of course. We were forced.
Yeah, well, I was forced to come to church. I was forced to come to Sunday school. I didn't have the day to day like 50 cents to put in the Sunday school. Not only has he saved us, but now he's given us a mind for us to learn about him. Because what God really wants is that relationship with us. Okay, so let me go on because I get too far away. He says, I will be glad and what? And rejoice in thee. Now, I will sing praises to thy name, O thou most high. I will be glad and rejoice in thee. I was reading something, and listen to this. I thought this was so good. Holy joy is the life of a thankful praise, as thankful praise is the language of holy joy. I said, oh, that sounds real good. I don't know what it means. What's holy joy? What is holy joy? Happiness? Okay. Whatever makes us glad, our joy must come through. If we get glad of something, there's some joy going through it. Like, Pastor, he's glad because the Cowboys in first place, they play good ball and everything. You know, he got some joy going through there, you know. He walk around with his stuff, but now, oh, Virginia too. Now, you know, fatty little old dad, you know, their joy is going through their happiness there. But what is holy joy? Holy joy is not the same as the joy I just described. Holy joy is that, yeah, your joy goes through your happiness, but it ends because of God. Here's one. A person gets a new car. Happy. Joy passes through that. And they happy. That's the out of happiness. Gets a new car. Joy passes through that. And they say, thank you, Lord. Not praising the gift, but praising the giver. All of our happiness and joy, when we realize it, it's not because of the material things, whatever, it's because God has done it. And when we end up with our joy going through our happiness, and it ends up giving God the praise, that's holy joy. You know, only because of God, I got this. Only because of God, I got joy that the world can't take away. Why are you smiling when you're going through all these troubles? Because I know God. And I know that never got to see freedom, they're, so now, I will be glad and rejoice. I want to find some joy, some holy joy in the things that God has done, his marvelous things. And I still will sing praises unto who? His name. I'm still singing praises unto his name. Oh, thou most high. Now, I told you not to rejoice in the gift, but rejoice in the giver, right? Now, also, there's the triumph or the victory of the Redeemer. Who's that? Who's our Redeemer? And the Son, Jesus. Okay. He was victorious in what he does, right? So he is triumphed over what he has done, redeemed. But see, if we're part of God, if we're part of the family, then we can also rejoice with the Redeemer for what he's done. We can rejoice also for what he's done. Okay? So I'm going to throw you Revelation 12:10. Somewhere in the book of Revelation, in the end, Satan, the accuser, is no longer talking to God. He's all the time about us. He's cast down. He's on his way for destruction. Revelation 15:3 says, for thy judgments are made manifest, that his judgments have come to pass. Okay? Now David goes on in 9:3 to acknowledge the almighty power of God as that which is the strongest of his enemies, which no way are able to stand before him. Do you realize that when these slaves left Egypt, you know, freed from the Israelites. And they went, do you know that they were never trained as warriors? You know, I mean, you know, when you do the army, you had to go to basic training and everything. Back in those days, you know, you were trained how to use a sword, javelin, you know, techniques of war. These Israelites were never really trained in that. They were slaves, you know. But all the way from leaving Israel, they defeated the most powerful army in the world, Egypt. They didn't, but who did? God. When they went through the wilderness, they had to fight against all the kings and everything. They didn't want them coming near that. They had victory, not because of their great strength, but because of when they got to the promised land. They had to fight different people that were in different parts of the promised land to take their land. First one was Jericho. They had to take Jericho, but they wasn't as strong as Jericho was. And Jericho had great walls, but they won because of David now says, when my enemies are turned back, they shall fall and perish at thy presence. The reason why the Israelites won all these battles is because the presence of God was with them. And you know what? They used to carry the Ark of the Covenant. And that was to them the presence of God. It symbolized the presence of God. God is with them. Even when they was walking through the wilderness, the cloud by day, the fire by night was above them. That was the presence of God. So they always felt the presence of God was with them. And he was. And when they went up against their enemies, the enemies wasn't just fighting Israelites. They were fighting the presence of God. Now, who can stand before the presence of God? No. Now, there is something I've never really realized this, like never hit me like this, but Jesus, when he was about to be betrayed, right, and they came and they were looking for him with Judas on that side and they were coming to look for him. I didn't realize this, but in John 18:6, it says, let me go above it, I'll start at 4. Jesus, therefore, knowing all things that should come upon him, went forth and said unto them, the soldiers were there looking for him. He says, whom do you seek? Right? And they answered and said, we're looking for Jesus of Nazareth. And Jesus said to them, here's what he says, I am he. He says, who you seek? I'm looking for Jesus of Nazareth. I am he. When he said that, they went backward and fell to the ground. Because they were confronted with the presence of the Lord. He had all the power. It just knocked them back to the ground. And he could have killed them. But then, but that was symbolizing the presence of the Lord was there. You can't come against the presence of the Lord. David says that his enemies, they turned back. When they were confronted with the presence of the Lord, they turned back. And they shall fall and perish at thy presence. And here's the key thing. The next verse is the key thing. Yeah, the enemies cannot stand against the presence of God. But even when Joshua was about to take over Jericho, they crossed the river and they were going to try to take Jericho. Remember they had to march around there? They were ready to do battle. And all of a sudden he looked up and seen a man. doing what God's will. We're not in the will of God. And so the captain of God's army said, I'm not with you and I'm not with them. I'm with the Lord. And who you with? You know? And obviously, they were doing what God said and God told them what to do. But that just signifies that, yeah, they could be seeing the presence of God, but God, for us to have God on our side, God is not on our side. We have to be on his side. So Israel, most of the time, they were on God's side in the beginning. And you see different times when they went their own ways and they lost and every kind of thing, the battles turned against them because they had gotten away from being on God's side. Now, for thou hast maintained, now check this out, my right and my cause. David said this. Thou hast maintained my right and my cause. Long as my right and my cause align with God's right and God's cause. Okay? Thou sat in the throne judging right. It is God who does the judging. David says God is sitting on the throne. Now we're talking about righteousness. The only person that can judge righteous is a righteous person. And there is no righteous person but. There is no one good but. And he is the one that sits on the throne. Now remember what was in Revelation? He sits on the throne. He's been sitting on the throne. When we went through this pandemic, we were worrying about the virus, and people dying and all that. All that's true, but God's still sitting on the throne. We could die this minute, but God's still sitting on the throne. Get from that short-sighted view of our problems and remember, God is the one that's sitting on the throne. He's the one that's in charge. So he says, thou hast rebuked the heathens, and that's another word for enemies. Thou hast rebuked the enemies. Thou hast destroyed the wicked, and thou hast put their name for it, has put out their name forever and ever. Now, when you first read that, you'll start thinking about what we talked about before when we read Psalm 136, with God. So he hasn't completely wiped them all out. But then, look in the future here. America. There might come a time when we continue not to honor God anymore, where grace, Egypt was just as great as America. There was a lot of cultures greater than that that are no longer around because God has, because, first of all, he warns them. It says, all thou enemy, destruction to come to a perpetual end, and thou hast destroyed cities, their memorials, is perished with them. And right before that, the Bible says, thou hast rebuked the enemy, thou hast destroyed the wicked, and thou hast put their name out forever. But he just didn't come upon them. He warned them. He warns us. Thou shalt not honor God but me. We continue to put other gods up there, and we serve, we live in a society where there's, you know, we act like there ain't no other gods. There's so many other gods walking around here that people are worshiping. And then we live in a world here where everything about God we have to take out. We got to be politically correct. We can't say this. We see things that are wrong. We can't say they're wrong. We see things. You know what I'm saying? If God is going to be with us, he ain't going to be with us if we're not following him. The presence of the Lord ain't with us. So when we go in front of the enemy, we don't have the presence of the Lord, we're really fighting with our own strength. So now, David records with joy the triumphs of God of heaven over the power of his enemies. He does three things to his enemy. First of all, he had checked them. He has rebuked the heathens. Now, I don't know if y'all ever played chess, but when you get ready to kill the king, you check them. That's a warning. Yeah, you know, if you're in the street, somebody bothering you, you check them because the next time you'll be on it. Right? But God has checked it. Has checked them, and he says to them, thou hast rebuked the heathen. He's telling them they're wrong. He's telling them they're wrong. Then they continue. He had cut them off. He's destroyed the wicked. And then they continue. He has buried them in oblivion. He wiped their name out forever. My God. So David also, in 6, he exalts over the enemies whom God appeared against. Their destruction is just, and that God was but reckoning with them for evil they had done. God's justice is righteous. And when God sends out his justice, it's going to be right. All these people tell us when you go to, when you die, you go in front of the God, he tells you, you know, you didn't have no excuse for what you're saying, right? And we'll get to that part in a minute. But there is no injustice in God's justice. We deserve whatever we have done. Now, us as Christians, we deserve that. But Christ died for us so that we don't have to pay that price. So by our faith, we have everlasting life. Ain't that good? That's just, that's God's righteousness. He doesn't see you. He sees the righteousness of Christ in you, covers you. Is anybody ever done that? Because if he saw you, I don't care how good you did or what you've been doing, your righteousness is no good. But if by faith, just because I believe by faith that God sent Jesus because he loves me to save me from destruction, which sin is, that's the payment for sin is destruction. rule up for the judge, the righteous judge. He's the one. There's no Supreme Court above him. He's the author. He's the final. He's the author and finisher of your faith. What God says is done. So, I'm so glad that I don't have to pay for my sins. I'm so glad that even if I sin tomorrow, Jesus already paid the price. I'm so glad of what he's done that now I don't want to be sinning. That's why I'm always fighting. Like Paul said, when I want to do good, evil's always present. I try my best to do it, but I fall sometimes, but God loves me that much. Jesus' blood is covering me, and he picks me up and blesses me off. Try again. Do better. And I want it. I want it because now I'm getting a relationship with God now. You know, me and him, I want to please him. So, it says, but after all that, number 7, I like that, starts out with but. But the Lord, no matter what my enemies have done, and they get destroyed and all this, they're doing their thing, but the Lord shall endure forever. And ask how long was ever?
I don't know, right?
Forever. But the Lord, now check this out, but the Lord shall endure forever. He has prepared his throne for judgment. And you know what that is? He's preparing his throne for judgment right now. He's preparing when many people will come and follow him, and books gonna be open. Their name ain't gonna be in it. And he's gonna pronounce judgment on them because now they got to pay for their own sins. Death. Right? Now, there's a throne being prepared for judgment. And if you read in the Revelation, it says the throne of judgment. Right? Now, what you want to do when you get to the throne of judgment? David, you know that. You don't know? Guess what? What you want to do? You ain't gonna be there. What you gonna do with the throne of judgment? How about you ain't gonna be there? The throne of judgment is not for the church, not for the believers. When you get into the Revelation, there's gonna be a rapture when Jesus comes, not all the way back to earth in the sky, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, and those the rest of all in Christ will meet Christ in the air, because Christ hasn't come back the second time yet. He's coming to get his church. He's coming to get all those whose faith believers. And he's taking y'all out of here with him. Now, ain't that good news? Because what's getting ready to happen next is the tribulation years is when God starts raining his anger on all these unrighteous on the earth for 7 years. It starts slowly, death, all kinds of stuff. But you ain't gonna be here. But God is always gonna hold his anger. And now it's getting close to the time of judgment. And during those 7 years, when all kinds of stuff start happening, and all kinds of diseases and God sends all kinds of plagues and God does all kinds of stuff where people are trying to die, you know. It's going to be a terrible time. But you ain't going to be here. Now, there are going to be some that turn to the faith during that time. Some. But you ain't going to be here. And then those that turn to this still going to be walking through the tribulation period. And then at the end of the tribulation is when the great that's why the psalm, praise God for justice and righteousness, we're praising God because he's the righteous judge. He's going to do justice. And all I'm trying to teach us now is that we've got to stop being sheep-sighted, short-sighted, and kind of see the bigger picture. The bigger picture is that God will straighten out everything. He said, one day I'm going to wipe away all tears. He said, I'm going to get rid of this earth. I'm going to get rid of this. There's going to be a new earth and a new heaven. All wickedness, all troubles will cease. All the problems we have now, gone. Because God's going to make that Garden of Eden back the way he intended it to be. Without sin, without the enemy. So, as you go through your problems and situations, keep your faith. In the end, before forever gets here, in the end, you win. Not only do you win, you get justice. And not only do you get justice, it's justice by the righteous king. The God, the king of all kings, the Lord of all lords. He's the one that's going to administrate the justice to the wicked. All those that have been oppressed and been troubled, he's going to get their payback. Now, the Lord will also be a refuge for the oppressed and a refuge in time of trouble. So what does that mean? That means that while I'm feeling like I ain't getting no justice, while people getting all over me, while I'm in trouble, I don't deserve it, I don't know why, I got to remember that the Lord is my refuge. I might not see justice coming, but I can take my troubles and everything, and I take them to the Lord, and he's my refuge. He's my help. I've got to understand that my feelings that I can't control or can't understand, I don't have to suffer with it. I can take these burdens, these things that are bothering me, and I take them to the Lord. Because he is my refuge. He's my hiding place. So he doesn't leave us to be out there just sick and downtrodden. He says, the troubles that you're in, the things that's bothering you, all that, give them to me. Come to me. I'll take care of them. Get behind me. They got to come through me. They're going to come through God. And so now, even in the midst of troubles, you can understand how to just be afraid of God. Because not he's going to actually take care of all that. But in the meantime, before he takes care, he's still going to help you get through it. And he says, bring them to me. You my refuge. You're my help. Come. And so we got to learn that in the midst of this, the troubles that we're in down here, we're always going to have trouble. Man, born of a woman is a few days and full of trouble. We're always going to have trouble. But we got to realize that this trouble don't last always. And the trouble that burdens me down, I've got to learn to take it to the Lord. He's my refuge. And if I do that, it takes that burden off of me. And all of a sudden, I can start remembering the marvelous work he's done. I can start recalling the great things he's done for me. And if I can recall all these things that he's done for me, I can look ahead and I can see the things he's going to do for me. And if I ain't all that sure, I can go back to the book and I can cheat and go to the end of the story and find out the great things he's done for me. in his word where he lies, you can lose your hope. But there is none. God has never lied. He's not like a man. He doesn't lie. And his word don't change. So now, get close. where am I at now? Not in here. So now, the text says, oh, I love this. And they that know thy name will put their trust in thee. You hear that? They that know his name. They that have a relationship with him. They that know him can put their trust in God. Okay? And he knows that they haven't forsaken them that seek him. And he ends up telling everybody to sing praises to the Lord. Okay? So my time is about, I think it's 7 up. I mean, 12 of the Cowboys there back then. But do y'all